وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين لا سيما بقية الله في الأرضين أرواحنا له فداء. أما بعد، فقد قال الله سبحانه وتعالى في كتابه الكريم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، قال قائل منهم لا تقتلوا يوسف وألقوه في غيابة الجب يلتقطه بعض السيارة إن كنتم فاعلين. صدق الله العلي العظيم. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته مؤمنين ومؤمنات.
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله
وبركاته. First and foremost, I give my condolences to each of you on the occasion which we are coming to commemorate, and that is the shahadat of Imam Hussein, his companions, and his Ahlul Bayt alayhim afdhalu salat wa salam. As we've been discussing the social and emotional skill of empathy, understanding how to connect with others, understand their pain, understand their happiness, understand their moments of joy, understand their moments of sadness. Because through connecting to individuals in this way, we're able to start moving towards justice and social justice. For a moment, I want to reflect a bit on the two letters that we mentioned yesterday. One was the letter of Imam Hussein alayhi salatu wasalam to the people of Kufa, and the other was the letter of Yazid, because this will help us to segue into this idea and understanding of social empathy. Because so far we wanted to identify, on one hand, how we ourselves, we are connecting to the Shuhada of Karbala. Perhaps we are inclined or we connect to one of those individuals and we are saddened, especially when we hear their maqtala, when we hear about the story, the event of their martyrdom. Sometimes we may connect to all of them. And as I said, sometimes some folks, they, in a setting where we are in the masjid or we're in the center of Husseiniya, you may have that one uncle or auntie who is very emotionally connected, and we connect to them. We hear them crying, and they're sad, and then that sets the foundation or lays a foundation for our own sadness. But in any case, that is a interpersonal connection of empathy. But that interpersonal connection or empathy should lead to something greater, to what is called a social empathy. And what do we mean by this? What is meant by that is that when we connect to someone, we connect to their situation, it's not simply to look at that individual and perhaps simply help that individual. To give an example, we may, you know, as many of us may do, inshallah, and if we're not, then we should be doing. We should be giving sadaqah. We give some sort of charity. Or even at the very least, we give our zakat, zakatu fitr. This is wajib, it's obligatory upon us. And sometimes we can give that zakat to, or we can give that charity to someone, understanding that, oh, well, this individual is a person who is in need, meets that criterion whereby they are eligible to receive this zakat or this charity. So that's one way of looking at it. And we understand and we connect with them in that situation. But social empathy goes a bit beyond that. Social empathy goes towards, well, why is this person in this situation? What has happened? Socially, what has happened? What is the social structure that exists at this moment that has created this situation, whereby you have individuals who may be in this situation? And is it possible that if there is a difference in the way the social structure is, would this person be able to come out of this situation of poverty, this situation of need, or even if it's not a financial need, but that person may be suffering some sort of emotional breakdown. That person may be suffering from other elements of oppression, for example. So if, and we identify, oh, well, this person is being oppressed, but what is leading to that oppression on a societal level? And that is social empathy, understanding the reasons behind that, and then doing our part. Just like Allama Iqbal, he stated in that poem, and I'm not going to read that poem over again, but where he says that young person, that boy, was sitting on the branch, and this small glowworm came. He said, well, you know what? I'm small, but I'm going to play my part. I can light up the path for you. If that's the only thing I can do, that even if I'm small and seem to be insignificant. So social empathy, again, this is leading us in the direction of justice. So social empathy is understanding that, well, what is happening in society and how can I address that? And we see that in the letter of Imam Hussein alayhi wasalam. And of course, that erosion of social empathy we see in the letter of Yazid. Because Yazid, when he writes that letter to Ibn Ziyad, as we mentioned, that from the very beginning, he frames or actually dehumanizes a person who he's in opposition with, and that is Imam Hussein alayhi wasalam. He basically tells Ibn Ziyad, well, he's like a slave to you. And if you want, u'tiq, then free the slave. If not, then you bring the slave, or you make him go back in a state where he's in utter humiliation and subjugation. And this is basically what the letter of Yazid said to Ibn Ziyad. And of course, Ibn Ziyad in a position of power over Kufa, again, this is what he's going to disseminate throughout that society among those people. And this is why he used his power, again, to threaten individuals that, look, you have to either stand with me or you're against me. And if you're against me, then you'll die. Even according to some of the historical accounts, yes, there were individuals who, again, they sided with Yazid because out of fear. And as they were marching out from Kufa to Karbala, some people actually fled. They abandoned the camp, and then they never returned back. This is according to one of the accounts of history. And then, of course, more people were, of course, to come out of Kufa to stand on the side of Ibn Ziyad to fight against Imam Hussein alayhi wasalam. But in any case, the letter to Yazid, it is, on one hand, a sign, and it shows the erosion of empathy, not simply on the individual or interpersonal level, where Yazid himself, he has a problem with Imam Hussein, he says he's at odds with Imam Hussein, but it is on a social level, because this is what he is ordering his governor to do, or to take this position, and that position will be established within that city. Where social empathy, it is something that we see in the letter of Imam Hussein, that the imam or someone who is a lead, who's leading, someone who establishes justice, someone who is habisu nafsuhu an dhatillah, that individual holds back his own nafs, that he doesn't act or operate based on his own whim, but rather he holds that back and operates based on the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's that individual who has rahmah, love and compassion in his heart for, again, those people over whom he has authority. And of course, that letter of Imam Hussein alayhi wasalam, it summarizes the position that Imam Ali alayhi wasalam, he also had. And we mentioned this, but I wanted to point out a few places within that letter of Imam Ali to Malika Ashtar to show this. Because it's important for us to understand what is the philosophy of governance as is laid out by the Ahlul Bayt alayhim al-Salatu wasalam. And this is, and particularly Imam Ali alayhi salatu wasalam, because his government as well, if we go to one of the documents that is written by the UN, I saw this document, I read the document. Again, they rave over the governance of Imam Ali. They says there is no government that is more just than Imam Ali. And they say from all of the examples of government and governance, that the government of Imam Ali alayhi salatu wasalam is one of a kind, that it has not, no one has been able to establish a government as such. And if they believe this, and if they understand this, my question is, well, why not use those protocols that Imam Ali alayhi salatu wasalam himself, he put into place? And they're right there in Nahjul Balagha. It is in that letter of Imam Ali to Malik Ashtar. So in that letter, at one point, Imam Ali, he tells Malik Ashtar, he says, وَأَشْعِرْ قَلْبَكَ الرَّحْمَةَ لِلْرَّعِيَّةِ وَالْمَحَبَّةَ لَهُمْ وَاللُّطْفَ بِهِمْ. Again, that he uses that word, أَشْعِرْ, which comes from shu'ur. We explained it in the very beginning, that the sha'air of Allah, the shu'ur, to have that feeling. He says, وَأَشْعِرْ قَلْبَكَ. Again, enlighten your heart, or inflame your heart, or habituate your heart, as some of the translation states. Habituate your heart to have rahmah, to have mercy for those individuals who are under your authority. Rahmah lirra'iyyah. This is empathy. Rahmah wa mahabba, and have love for them. Mercy and love wa lutf, and be graceful towards them. Again, some of us, as I mentioned, that, you know, Obama, he had the same idea. He says, well, when we select a Supreme Court judge, that judge should have empathy. Of course, we know what the response was. Oh, no, empathy needs to be eradicated, because governance is just raw power. Has nothing to do with mercy. Has nothing to do with empathy. But if, again, the United Nations, meaning all these nations who are coming together, they say, oh, the most just government is that of Amir al-Mu'mineen. This is the governance of Amir al-Mu'mineen, where he's saying that have mercy, love, and grace, compassion for whom? For your subjects, your citizens. And where do we find this around the world? Have love for them. Then Imam Ali, he says, وَلَا تَكُونَنَّ عَلَيْهِمْ سَبُعًا ذَارِيًا تَغْتَنِمُوا أَكْلَهُمْ فَإِنَّهُمْ سَنْفَانِ إِمَّا أَخٌ لَكَ فِي الدِّينِ وَإِمَّا نَذِيرٌ لَكَ فِي الْخَلْقِ. He says, and don't stand over your citizens, over your subject, as carnivorous beast, waiting to eat them, waiting to consume them. He says, don't stand over them like that. He says, because those individuals who are among you, who are your citizens, who are your subjects, who are under your authority, he says, either they're your brother in deen, they share the same ideology as you, or they're your equal in creation. Again, you remember that Misr, Egypt at that time, is on the border of the Byzantine Empire. And there were Christians living there. There were Jews who were living there. Perhaps people of other faiths, we don't know. One would have to do deeper research to find that out. But nonetheless, there were Christians there. There were people who were not Muslim. And so Imam Ali is telling Malik Ashar how to govern over these individuals. Meanwhile, some think that, oh, well, we have to separate religion and state in order to have a peaceful society. No. Yes, you'll have people of your same faith, but if the one who is governing has that love and has that compassion for his citizens, no matter what that citizen's ideology is, whether they have share the same ideology or whether they have a different ideology. So either they're your brother in creation, no matter what their ideology is, or your brother in faith, in the same ideology. So Imam Ali alayhi salatu wasalam, he sets the principles and the foundations for that. Again, we don't have to wait till someone says it in this century or this era, but no, it's already been established by Imam Ali. But this also, as I said, having that love and compassion for your fellow man, it doesn't lead to a position of weakness, as some may think or some may assume. In that same letter to Malik Ashra, he says, وَلَا يُكُونَنَّ الْمُحْسِنُ وَالْمُسِيءُ عِنْدَكَ بِمَنْزِلَةٍ سَوَى. He says, well, even though you have that love, you have that compassion, and you treat your citizens with grace, he says, then realize that the person who is muhsin, who is good, who is upright, who is just, should not be the same as that individual who is wrong, who is wicked, that individual who breaks the laws. No, everyone has to be held accountable. Those individuals who are breaking the laws, those individuals who are creating disturbances within the society, they have to be held accountable. So don't overlook them and just pass off their wickedness, their disobedience to order. Don't overlook that. Again, hold them accountable. But then when you hold them accountable, again, if we are looking at the example of Mir al-Mu'mineen, Ali ibn Abi Talib, then you hold them accountable justly. We don't do like the other advice. If someone hits you, then you hit them five times harder than they've hit you. Or you got to get them back. You have to get the revenge. No, this is not the principles that Amir al-Mu'mineen laid down. In fact, when Amir al-Mu'mineen was struck by Ibn Muljim al-A'in, he told Imam Hassan alayhi salatu wasalam, he says, but look, he says, if I live, then I will deal with him according to the laws. If I die from that blow, then he told Imam Hassan alayhi salam, he said, then you strike him an equal blow. Not harder, not softer, equal. This to the same measure and to the same degree. And that's it. So this is the principles that Imam Ali alayhi salatu wasalam, he lays down in order to establish social empathy, in order to bring about, again, justice within the society. And of course, when we look at these documents, and even if we look at the verses of Quran that we mentioned earlier, that outlines the reasons for which there is the erosion of empathy within an individual, again, love for this world, running after this world, being heedless of the akhirah, the hereafter, which inshallah we'll examine a little bit more, because those things also speak about the akhlaq of, or the moral dimension of empathy, which again, in order to reach that level of establishing justice, then each individual has to instill within themselves as well the ethics of empathy. Again, so that they will be able to avoid their sense of empathy, their sense of connecting with people, identifying with their needs, their pains, so that one can respond appropriately, so that one can give the appropriate support. So once you're able to have that moral dimension of empathy, you build it up, so you will steer clear of having your compassion, your love, as Imam Ali alayhi salatu wasalam, he's saying that one should have, especially in a position of leadership, for your fellow citizens. And to emphasize that, in that same letter to Malik Ashtar, near the end of that letter, and I want to focus on this a little bit more, because it is very interesting how Imam Ali alayhi wasalam, he outlines this advice to Malik Ashtar with regards to the citizens of Egypt. And he says that, you know, you have people who are different classes, showing that, yes, not everyone will have the same status within society, financial status in society. You know, you have people who are wealthy, you have people who are poor, you have people who are doing okay. And it shows that Islam is not advocating socialism. Well, everybody has to be of the same. No, people will be of different classes. But as Imam Ali alayhi wasallam, he states that those individuals of different classes, he says that that society will only prosper when everyone does their part, when everyone is supporting and helping one another. And again, it's based on pun, that sense of love and compassion, ar-rahma wal-muhabba wal-lutf, and acting gracefully among one another. And of course, not giving someone who is musi, someone who is doing wickedness, someone who is breaking the law, not giving them a free pass. No, hold them accountable, as Imam Ali said. But among those individuals of the various classes that Imam Ali alayhi wasallam, he points out to Malik al-Ashtar, he says that among them is tabaqatu sufla. He says, there's the lowest class of individuals. The lowest class of individuals. Individuals that may be struggling, as Imam Ali alayhi wasallam, he points out. He says, who are these individuals? He says, من الذين لا حيلة لهم. It's those people who, again, they're in a tough situation. And they may not have the means to pull themselves out of that situation. And who are these individuals? He says, "Wal masakin, the masakin, wal muhtajin, wa ahl al bu'sa wa zamna." When we look at this advice from Imam Ali alayhi wasallam, one of the things that we notice is that Imam Ali, again, he does not lump all of those individuals in the same problem. So no. Why doesn't he list them all and say, oh, these are just poor people? So, yes, definitely be careful of them, you know, give them their right. You know, Imam Ali alayhi wasallam, with each of these titles, because as we know, the Imams, they do not waste their words for anything. But what Imam Ali alayhi wasallam, he's pointing out the reason for which these individuals are of tabaq al-sufla. Why are they among the lowest class or financial class of the society? What's going on? What is their issue? Because he simply could have said, oh, well, they're poor. Tabaqatu sufla, and then simply said that, okay, tabaqatu sufla, they're fuqara, they're poor, and, you know, give them their haq. But Imam Ali, he's specifically pointing out the state of people. Those individuals who are masakin, muhtajin, ahlul bu'sa, wa zamna, four types of people. And they each are different. The masakin, the miskin, again, it's not like the individual who is yatim. Yatim is someone who is orphaned, their father died when they were young. Again, if their father died, then perhaps they have, their mother is there to raise them, to bring them up, to rear them, to instill within them certain values. The miskin is that individual who, again, according to the fiqh, that miskin is someone whose mother and father has died. That individual who may not have someone who is bringing them up as they should be brought up. That miskin may be that individual as well, because their parents passed away, that, again, doesn't have the type of inheritance or anything like that to sustain them. That person is miskin. That person is destitute. Although the translation, if you look at the English translation, uses another word, says person who is poor, yes, but the miskin is more than just poor. That individual is usually in a worse shape because of, again, not having the tribal support, family support that he or she should have. So that person is miskin. That person grew up in poverty because of that. Then you have the muhtajin, someone who is needy. And perhaps their need is not a dire need. It's not something that, oh, well, the person has, you know, some sort of need, but in any case, perhaps they need just a little push, and that person would be able to be on their way to elevating and lifting themselves. This is muhtaj, someone who has a need. Perhaps not able to make all their ends meet, maybe to make most of their ends meet, but one bill is left or something. For some reason, they're struggling. And if they had a little help, then they would be on their way and perhaps come out of that situation of being needy, muhtaj. Then you have the ahlul bu'sa. Ahlul bu'sa, this means someone who misfortune has befallen. Someone who is in extreme poverty. Ahlul bu'sa. To give an example, someone who went bankrupt. Someone who entered into some sort of business transaction, lost all of their money. Lost all of their financial support. This is ahlul bu'sa. Then the zamna. Zamna is someone who is disabled, meaning that they have an illness, they have an ailment, there's something that's going on with them that it is not a temporary situation of ailment. Zamna, meaning from zaman, meaning that it is something that is lasting for the duration of their lifetime. And because of that, that individual is not able to have his needs met. Pretty much like the leper that Imam Ali alayhi wasallam, that he would come and he would take care of, bring food to that individual, to help that and water and help that individual with whatever he needed. That same individual who, again, he fainted on the grave of Imam Ali alayhi wasallam, and he passed away after the martyrdom of Imam Hussein out of sadness and grief for Imam Hussein. So again, having that social empathy is what Imam Ali alayhi salatu wasalam is telling to Malik al-Ashar, that if he has that rahmah, that mahabba, that mercy and that love and that lutf for those individuals who are his subject, again, know why they're in that situation. Who are those individuals who are poor in that society? Who are the individuals who are miskeen, who are muhtaj, who are ahlul bu'sa, who are zamna, who are disabled, who are in extreme poverty because of misfortune befalling them? Who are those individuals? Because then that will give you an understanding of how to help those individuals. And as Imam Ali, he says, with regards to those individuals, Imam Ali, he says, make sure that you give them their rights, that they have a right from Baytul Mal. They have a haqq of Baytul Mal. And don't overlook their right. Make sure that they are given their due properly. And if we, just as an aside, go to, again, that story that we have in the Quran, one that throughout the entire story, basically from beginning to end, as I've mentioned, the story of Yusuf, that we see empathy at work. That's how the Prophet Nabi Yusuf alayhi salam, how he had empathy for the society, for the people. Again, when he interpreted their dream for the Aziz, he saw this very strange dream with, you know, the ears of corn and the cattle. Some of the cattle are thin. And then Yusuf, he said that, well, what has to be done is that you have to plant your crop because you will have 7 good years. Then after that, there's going to be 7 bad years. So how you deal with this is that you plant the crop, and then whatever comes out of the crop, you store. You put some away. You put a little bit away, and you only leave out what people will eat. So in other words, the Prophet Yusuf is saying, we have to ration the food. It has to be rationed. And there must be a storage. This Baytul Mal has to be stored. And Yusuf could have said this, and he knew what was going to happen. So, oh, well, you know what? Since Egypt is going to face this, well, you know, I'm going to leave. Because, again, he was freed from prison. I'm going to leave. I'm going to go to a place that's not going to be afflicted with this calamity. He's a prophet of Allah. But no, he stayed. And not only did he stay, he told the Aziz, he says, اجعلني على خزائن الأرض إني حفيظ عليم. He says, make me the treasurer. Make me the one who is overseeing this storage of food. He says, and you'll find that I am حفيظ عليم. that I am the one who will protect it, and I am the one who has knowledge, again, to each and everyone's needs. Those who are wealthy, who in that time of difficulties, they're going to need food. Those individuals who are already poor, who are going to need food, what is the amount that they need? Again, he stayed. And why? Because he had compassion and love for the people. He had empathy for those individuals. He could have been selfish. I'll leave and just save myself and spare myself. But no, but having that compassion and empathy and love for the people is what is taught by Ahlul Bayt alayhim afdhalus salam. And we see this throughout the movement of Imam Hussein alayhi afdhalus salam from Medina to Mecca to Karbala. And we already mentioned how there were individuals who did not want to make the bay'ah to Yazid, knowing his characteristic, knowing that, again, he had no compassion for anyone, knowing that his sense of empathy had been eroded, and he's only thinking about his own power, his own position. So even Imam Hussein alayhi salatu wasalam encountered individuals whom he tried to instill within them this understanding of social empathy, to stand with Imam Hussein, to stand against this injustice. One of those individuals was Abdullah ibn Umar. That, of course, he fled to Mecca during the lifetime of Muawiyah, when Muawiyah was trying to get the bay'ah, and also right after when Muawiyah had died, Yazid was now getting the bay'ah. So one of those persons who also went to Mecca was Abdullah ibn Umar. Of course, he reached there after Imam Hussein. Abdullah ibn Zubair, he went before Imam Hussein seeking out to avoid even responding to Walid ibn Uqba, his call to make bay'ah in Medina. So he left and went to Medina. Imam Hussein, of course, he went to Mecca. He went to Mecca as well. And shortly thereafter, Abdullah ibn Umar, he went as well. Imam Hussein encountered Abdullah ibn Umar in Mecca. Again, he told him, he says, look, he said, join me. And Abdullah ibn Umar, he said, Yazid has money, he has wealth, he's going to call the people to make bay'ah to him. And Abdullah ibn Umar, he says, I'm afraid that, for your life, why don't you just make bay'ah? Imam Hussein responded saying that look, he says, if you look at what happened to the Prophet Yahya, alayhi salam, that Bani Israel, again, killed him. And they brought his head on a platter for someone who was an adulteress. Again, the ruler at that time. He says, and then Bani Israel, they killed 70 prophets from dusk to dawn. Perhaps an account of one day. And then they went into the markets and they were buying and selling like nothing had happened. It says Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them relief at one time, meaning that Allah did not immediately, فَلَمْ يُعَجِّلَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ, that Allah, he didn't immediately get retribution from them. بَلْ أَمْهِلْهُمْ, that Allah let them stay for a while. Perhaps they will make tawbah. وَأَخَذَهُمْ بَعْدَ ذَٰلِكَ أَخْذَ عَزِيزٍ ذِنْتِقَامٍ. He says, but after that, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took his revenge as a person who is mighty and one who will take revenge. Again, pointing to those verses that we mentioned earlier, that Allah, عَزِيزٌ ذِنْتِقَامٍ. And this is why the mu'min, he does not seek revenge, because Allah will get his revenge. Then he tells Abdullah ibn Umar, he says, لَا تَدِعَنَّ نُصْرَتِي. He says, don't leave helping and aiding me. He said, you'll regret this. And said Abdullah ibn Umar, according to the account, that he cried, he wept, and he kissed Imam Hussein on his chest. And he says, I'm afraid that, if you go, you're going to be martyred. Again, knowing the tradition, the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, saying that Imam Hussein is Sayyid al-Shabab Ahl al-Jannah, that Imam Hussein would be martyred in Karbala. Knowing this, he turned back and went to Medina. And of course, according to the accounts of history, he made bay'ah with Yazid. And refusing to identify with the people, the masses of people, that they did not want such a leadership. Likewise, in Karbala itself, Imam Hussein alayhi salam, he sat down with Umar ibn Sa'd ibn Abi Waqas. And he told Umar ibn Sa'd, he says, Ya ibn Sa'd, wayhaka ataqatiluni? He says, woe be unto you. And again, Imam Hussein had set up a meeting with him and Umar ibn himself and Umar ibn Waqas. Umar ibn Sa'd, he said, that, are you going to engage in this battle? He says, listen, be conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أَمَا تَتَّقِ اللَّهِ الَّذِي إِلَيْهِ مَعَادُكَ. Do you not have, are you not conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who you will return to? وَأَنَا بِنُ مَنْ عَلِمْتَ. And I'm the son of someone that you know very well. And we need to understand who Umar ibn Sa'd is. Umar ibn Sa'd, he is the son of one of the companions of Rasulullah. Sa'd ibn Abi Waqas was a companion of Rasulullah. Umar is his son, who was born in Medina. Umar ibn Sa'd was born in Medina. Umar ibn Sa'd had a tribal affiliation with Muslim ibn Aqil. And when Muslim ibn Aqil, he was in the house, the governor's house of Ibn Ziyad in Kufa before he was martyred, and Muslim ibn Aqil knew he was going to be martyred, he asked to give his wasiyah. He gave the wasiyah to Umar ibn Sa'd. This is why? Because we have a tribal affiliation. So Imam Hussein says, you know me well. And again, Muslim ibn Aqil grew up in the household of Imam Hussein, like the brother of Imam Hussein. So Umar ibn Sa'd, he had no excuse. Umar ibn Sa'd was actually married to the sister of Mukhtar al-Thaqafi. Again, surrounded. And how did Umar ibn Sa'd, he end up in Kufa? Because when Imam Ali, he left from Medina and took the capital of the government to Kufa, Umar ibn Sa'd went with him. Umar ibn Sa'd was one of those individuals that went with Imam Ali. So Imam Hussein says, look, you know me well. Will you not have fear and taqwa Allah in engaging in this action that you're about to do? What was the response of Umar ibn Sa'd? He says, if I join you, then I'm afraid that, again, my house will be destroyed. Imam Hussein says, well, we'll build your house. Again, come and stand with the side of haq and truth. And then let's have victory. Well, I'll build your house myself. And he said, I fear that, again, my land, my gardens will be taken. Imam Hussein says, look, I will give you from my land that I have. And one of the lands that Imam Hussein had was in Hijaz, near Medina, that even Muawiyah wanted to buy for 1 million dirham. Imam Hussein, he refused. He said, I'll give this to you. Umar ibn Sa'd, he said, my family, they will be killed. My family will be in danger. Imam Hussein realized that, look, whatever is being said to him, he's not going to listen. That he does not have this empathy in his heart for the people, for justice, for doing what Imam Hussein wanted to do, as he said when he left Medina, to do islah fi jaddati ummi, to correct the wrongs of the ummah of my grandfather. And to show this and to establish this, we see that Imam Hussein, after the martyrdom of all of his companions, And then there was no one left but Bani Hashim. Imam Hussein, he sent his own son out to fight on the battlefield first. And imagine this. Imagine what it is like to lose a son. Imagine what it is like to, like a father, to lose a son. A father who, as most fathers would perhaps imagine or perhaps want that, again, well, I'll be buried by my son. And if there's anything that I left from my prayers or things like that, or my fasting, my eldest son, he will make those up. For a father to, again, to see and experience his son being martyred. I want to just mention one example.
Sheikh, we cannot hear you. You are on mute.
Okay. Can you hear me? Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. So I how long has it been on mute? Because I did not mute it. It's been on mute for a while or?
Few 1 or 2 minutes.
Okay. Okay. So Imam Hussein, after the martyrdom of all his companions, he sent forth his own son to the battlefield.
Sheikh, I think there is some glitch. Is getting muted again.
He is the one who was most like Rasulullah. He looks like Rasulullah. He sounds like Rasulullah. And whenever we wanted to look towards Rasulullah, then we look towards the son, Ali Akbar. So the Imam, he is saying, O Allah, bear witness against these people. Mawla kainat farman Ali Akbar ke bareme. Khalkan wa khulqan wa mantiqan bi rasulik. Mantiq may be, guftigu may be, bayan may be, rasul jaisa hai. Jo kirda mein rasul jaisa ho. Jo shiklo shamail rasul jaisa ho. Mantik or bayan mein rasul jaisa ho. This was Ali Akbar, the one who looked most like Rasulullah. This is the daughter, the son of Imam Hussein and Layla, Ali Akbar Yusuf and Layla, Guli Yasin Zahra, Shabihi Peyrambar, Azheimegah, Bekatlegah Mire, the son of Imam Hussein, Ali Akbar, is heading towards the battlefield. And as he headed towards that battlefield, according to the Maqtal, they say that some thought it was the Prophet of Allah who was coming towards them because he looked so much like Rasulullah. There was a, according to the history, that no one looked more like Rasulullah than Ali Akbar. So according to some of the accounts, that these individuals, they began to back away, thinking that Rasulullah had come to fight them on a battlefield. So Ali Akbar, he had to announce himself that who he was, that no, he was not Rasulullah, but he was of the household of Rasulullah. He began to say, Ana Ali ibn al-Husayn ibn Ali, nahnu wa baytillahi awla bin Nabi. We are the family, the close ones to an-Nabi. أطعنكم بالرمح حتى ينثني أضربكم بالسيف أحمي عن أبي. He says, I will strike you with my spear until it breaks. I will strike you with my sword defending the household of my father. ضرب غلام هاشمي عربي والله لا يحكم فينا بن. He says, I will strike you, the strike of a youth of al-Hashimi. Again, this the youth of Hashimi fighting like Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib. I will strike you down. And he says, I swear by Allah, the imposters, those who have a claim to authority, that they will never rule over me, those imposters. They said to Ali Akbar, as he was fighting on a battlefield, at one point, Layla, his mother, she looked at Imam Hussein, and she saw that Imam Hussein was beginning to worry. And she asked Imam Hussein, that what has happened? Has my son been martyred? Imam Hussein said, no, he has not yet been martyred, but someone has come forth, and I fear that this individual, as he fights Ali Akbar, that he may defeat Ali Akbar. Then Imam Hussein, he told Layla, he says, make dua for your son, because I heard my grandfather, I heard him say, إِنَّ الدُّعَاءَ الْأُمْ يُسْتَجَابُ فِي حَقِّ وَلَدِهَا. That pray for your son, Ali, pray for your son, because I heard my grandfather say that when a mother prays for her son, that dua will not be rejected. Pray for Ali Akbar. Layla, she prayed for Ali Akbar. Ali Akbar, he returned to the camp, telling his father, Ya Abata, ya, al-atash qatalani. That, oh my father, the thirst is killing me. This chain mail, the metal, it is hurting me, it is weighing me down. And Imam Hussein, he told Ali Akbar, he told him, Sabaran, ya bunaya, yusqika. He says, be patient a little while, my son, for your grandfather, he will come and he will give you to drink. He will give you a drink from the Kauthar, from the hose of Kauthar. And once you take this drink, you will never go thirsty again. So Ali Akbar, he went out to the battlefield. قتل منهم أربع وأربعين رجلا. As it said, that he went back out, he fought again, killing 44 men. But how much could this one boy, how much could Ali Akbar fight, thirsty, being surrounded by the enemies? Until he was struck in the head with a blow. He was struck in the head with a blow. And as he was falling to the ground, giving his father his final salutations. Baba, Akbar, akhiri, salam, qabul, farma. He was giving his salutations to his father. As-salamu alayka ya abata. He was giving his salutations according to the the maqtal. Instead of Allahu Akbar, he also called out from the battlefield. He also called out that, oh my father, Ya Abata Hada Jaddi Rasulullah. يسقيني بكأسه الأوفى. That, oh my father, I see our grandfather, I see Rasulullah, and he's bringing water to me. And he says he sees Rasulullah, and Rasulullah is saying, Ya Abu Ya Bunaya, Ya Hussein, hurry to me. He's, Rasulullah is saying for Hussein to come to him. Ali Akbar, his body upon the plains of Karbala was trampled by the horses, according to the Maqtal. So when he heard, when Imam Hussein heard the call of Ali Akbar, I said, Imam Hussein, he rushed out onto the battlefield. He rushed out onto the battlefield towards Ali Akbar. Oh, Hanuz, Chan Qadam, Bikushdaga, Ali Akbar Monde. جان قدم مانده بود خودش را از مرکب بر زمین انداخت زانو به زانو خود را به جوانش رساند اول نگاهی به آن بدن قطع قطع گفت امام حسین as he rushed out onto the plains of Karbala just before he reached the body of Ali Akbar he jumped off of his horse fighting the men away from the body of Ali Akbar and then he came forward seeing the trampled body of Ali Akbar seeing the cut body of Ali Akbar and he said قتل الله قوما قتلوك يا بني. That may Allah strike down those people who have cut you down, who have martyred you, O my son. إن لله وإنا إليه راجعون. وَسَيَعْلَمُ الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا أَيُّ مُنْقَلِبٍ يَنْقَلِبُونَ اللهم بحق هذا المجلس الحسيني اغفر ذنوبنا واستر عيوبنا وقضي حوائجنا واشفي مرضانا وارحم أمواتنا وعجل فرج مولانا صاحب العصر والزمان وجعلنا من أعوانه وانصاره والمستشهدين بين يديه وتحت لوائه بحق محمد وآله الطاهرين باتم حسين
يا حسين يا حسين so brother, يا حسين
Yes, I'm ready.
Okay, بسم الله صلوات اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد
Where has my Abbas gone? 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 O Abbas, who were my uncle, O Abbas, who were my brother. O Abbas, who were my son, like you there was no other. You went to search for water and search for so you searched so far and wide. You went for your brother's daughter and searched for her, you died. Where has my Abbas gone? 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 You hear the thirsty children, you hear them and you hurt. Their hopes are slowly dimming, see right out to Farad. Your brother was your master before you even ever drink. To Farad you rode much faster, Farad you only think. Where has my Abbas gone? Where has my Abbas gone? Where has my Abbas gone? Where has my Abbas gone?